right, hi everybody. Before I forget, can everybody please just put your cell phones on silent so that we don't have distractions? So good evening. I'm Shannon Palmer. I'm the PTA president at McNamara Elementary. And on behalf of myself and class Kathleen Jenny, she's the secretary, PTA secretary at Van Buren Elementary and at Ray Middle School. We'd like to thank those in attendance and viewing at home for coming out tonight. This event is something that we've been excited to do and discuss for years, so we're very excited to finally make it happen. To the candidates, thank you for demonstrating your commitment to our school district and for putting yourself forward. We understand the sacrifices that it is for you and your family, so thank you for making that possible. The Syracuse branch of the League of Women Voters has generously partnered with us to make this possible. They have been instrumental in organizing the structure of the evening. They've answered millions of our questions and helping spread the word. To Joan Durant and Mary Kahn especially, I'm wandering around. Thank you guys for your support and your civic duty commitment. To our Baldwinsville area PTAs, thank you for your support. We also wish to acknowledge as well Alpha Phi Omega, our volunteers over here for helping. If you guys have questions throughout the evening, you have index cards, they can bring you more if you need them. When you're done writing down your question, just hold it up and they can come and grab it and bring it up to us. So thank you guys. We'd also like to thank PACB for live streaming and recording, in particular Brian, without whom our viewers at home would not be able to access this important content. Finally, our moderator tonight, who has been kind enough to donate his time, he's not being paid or compensated in any way for tonight, Grant Reher, a deep and sincere thank you. Grant is the director of the Campbell Public Affairs Institute at Syracuse University, as well as professor of political science. He's written multiple books, and his journal publications include those found in Health Affairs, the Chicago Tribune, and the New York Times. Grant also hosts an award-winning weekly podcast called The Campbell Conversations, which features in-depth interviews with national writers, politicians, and business professionals. Definitely give it a listen. It's awesome. So we can't thank Grant enough for his time tonight. And again, thank you everybody for making this possible. So without further ado, I'll pass it on to Grant, who will tell us about the evening. Thank you.
Thanks very much. So first of all, I want to thank the organizers of this event because this type of information on down ballot races is getting harder and harder to find and to get reliably. So I think it's a great testament to them that they put this together. Doing these things it's not easy. One of the things that we do at the Campbell Institute is we put on a lot of events for the Maxwell School, and they take a lot of advanced planning and a lot of advanced work. So I really appreciate everything that went into that. I also want to echo the thanks to the candidates in particular. This job is often thankless that they're vying for. We know that they're not in it for the money. And so as a citizen, I'm grateful to them for putting themselves forward. And as we all know, school boards have become more and more in recent years a battleground for some of the cultural debates that are going on in the nation. And so that makes the job even harder and even raises the level of public scrutiny on some of the things that they do. So very appreciative for them. What we thought we would do for the format here for the evening is we did receive a healthy number of questions before the event, more than we could probably get to in an hour and a half. So we'll have to do some picking and choosing. We're getting questions now that I'm looking at here on the table. And so a lot of questions. And to that end, then, we won't have any introductory or concluding statements from the candidates. We're asking them to limit their responses to about a minute and a half at the longest. We've got a very well-versed timekeeper up here in the front row for them to keep an eye on, and I'll get involved if it becomes necessary. And I've had some experience doing that in the past, so I will stop you if you've gone on too long. One of the things that we talked about just briefly before we started here this evening, I talked about with the candidates, was rather than having each candidate answer each and every question, in order to avoid kind of candidate number five repeating what candidate number one said, once we hear an answer or two, I think what we'll do is we'll move to a format where, unless someone has something different or contrasting that they want to add to that question, then we'll move on to the next question. And we'll keep rotating the folks that are answering for the first couple times so that everybody has a chance to say something. But again, I just want to say to the seven candidates, if you do hear something and you want to add something new, by all means, don't hesitate. You know, we want to hear from you. It's just I don't know whether we need to hear three of you say the exact same thing. So we'll interpret silence as some sort of, you know, general agreement, I guess, with what's been said before. I think we'll want to try to save some questions. We'll work from the sheet of advanced questions, and we'll move to the questions that were just asked here tonight. We'll try to make sure that we incorporate as many of those as we can. Some of the questions are for a specific candidate. There are a few of those, but most of the questions are about the board in general and for the board more generally. So that's what will be the approach of most of them. The only other thing I have left to do is to give a quick introduction to the candidates. I want to just say that I'm only going to say a line or two about each of you. I'm going to go in the order in which your names appear on the web page that I'm going to direct everybody to. If you'd like to read in more detail about any of the seven candidates, they all have their bios up on the Baldwinsville Central School District website. If you Google, as I did earlier today, if you Google 2023 board candidates, Baldwinsville schools, you will hit this page and you'll be able to see this. So I'll just give a quick introduction, and again, I'll do it in the order in which they're appearing here, which is not alphabetical, so I'm not sure how it's organized, but we'll start with, Warren, great, thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks to you folks for doing that, too. Our first candidate is Luke Gasowski. He's right there in front. He is a critical care flight paramedic, respiratory therapist, and a clinical-based supervisor. He's worked in emergency medical services in different capacities for the past 20 years. He's also served on the Juwanio School Board and several different capacities. So thanks, Luke, for being here. Then we have Lindsay Atkinson. Did I say your last name right? Did I? Okay. And Lindsay is at Syracuse University in the Institute for Veterans and Military Families. I guess full disclosure, I've done work with the Institute, but not with you, Lindsay, but I've done work with the Institute with the Veterans in Politics program. She has past experience on a Board of Education in Carthage, and so she served a number of different roles in that previous experience. Then we have Don Miller back there, he is a former, well, I wanted to get you, Don, before, and I forgot to because I wasn't quite sure about some of your bios. Maybe you can help me right here. You're a teacher where?
Not currently teaching.
Okay, where were you a teacher? Because that was one of the questions.
Yeah.
So we're getting one of the questions early. Someone wanted to know, where were you a teacher, where were you a principal?
So I taught for 16 years. 14 of those years were at international schools in China. 1 year at an inner city school here in Syracuse, one at an inner city school in Chicago.
Okay.
And the principaling was, well, the principaling was Syracuse, Chicago, and 4 years of that in China.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, and so help me fill in his bio. Thank you, Don. And then we have Alyssa Cortina there in the front. She is a teacher in the Syracuse City School District. And she's been doing that for 14 years, and she is just about, I guess, now that we're in May, I guess this is the month that's going to happen, but she's about to earn her doctorate from American University in Educational Policy and Leadership. And we have Victor Jenkins also in the front row here. He worked for Xerox as a branch controller and held financial and investment positions at M&T Bank and at Morgan Stanley. And he has served for 12 years on the Baldwinsville Board of Education, including as president and vice president. And we have Andrew Henty there in the back. He has worked for medical device companies, including St. Jude Medical and Medtronic for 25 years. In the last 13 of those years, he was CEO and president of Metasource Management, and he has served on the Liverpool Central School District Board and has served as vice president in that capacity in that particular school board. And then finally, Tori Perez Shires, and she is has a lot of volunteer experience and is a part of the McNamara Elementary Parents Teachers Association. And I guess I have to say also, in full disclosure, we discovered to our mutual delight, former student of mine from many years back. So recognized her face, didn't remember the name, but the name has changed, I think, in part. So, but anyways, good to see her again. So thanks again to all of you. So Victor, you're going to be the first answer, the first question, and we've got one mic, so okay. We're going to have everybody getting up and getting down. It'll be a little bit of a shuffling exercise, but we felt that that would be better than trying to pass it around. So the first question is just a really basic one, and you're probably a good person to start with, but I think it came in on one of the cards, and I think it's an important question to start with, which is just simply and briefly, what are the job parameters of a school board member? And you might want to, I would say, is a friendly amendment to the question the way it was posed. What are the kinds of things that you don't have control over? Because a lot of times in these forums, people will say, why aren't you doing anything about X or Y? And it turns out that your position doesn't have anything to do about those things. So
that's a good place to start. I would like to start by, first of all, thanking everybody that came out tonight and thanking people that are on the Zoom call or whatever it is, and thanking the PTAs and the League of Women Voters. A board is an overseer. They are not an operator. They are not, most of them are not experts in the field. They should monitor. They should ask for ideas for improvement. They should assist. And most of all, they should try to create a positive culture, which is one of the things I think that needs to happen here, is create a more positive culture around the school. Encourage and support the staff, the teachers, the staff, and the administrators as they perform their duties. But they are overseers, they're not in operations, and they need to stay out of the weeds.
Thank you. Does Victor have the job description right? Does anybody want to add anything? Yeah, Tori, go ahead.
Echoing the thanks that Victor gave to everybody here, I also think it's really important to clarify that while being an overseer of the district, most importantly, the Board of Education are the direct supervisors of the superintendent of schools. And so that is the one job the board has, is to make sure we are providing the tools for the new superintendent to be as successful as possible. We have seen too many superintendents to count over the last few years, and making sure that there is a board who is ready and willing to be supportive of the superintendent, but not completely without unfailing questioning. So the role is, as any supervisor, to ask questions of your employees and to get an understanding, but to trust that they have the best interests of the organization at heart. The one role Grant didn't mention that I have is I am currently the Chief Development Officer at the Rescue Mission. So I have in-depth experience in working directly with a board of directors and understanding how a board can successfully work being a part of a 136-year-old organization. Thanks.
Sorry I missed that. Anybody else want to add anything to what the board members do and don't do? Okay. Luke, you're up first for this next one.
All right.
Luke, that sounds good. So you all seven of you have strong backgrounds. And I don't want to ask you a question about your resume. But the question is, other than your work background and your professional credentials, is there something that distinguishes you from the other six candidates? And before you answer that, if I could, I just want to remind people for those of you that are sorting this out. So you got seven candidates up here. You're going to elect four of them. The top three vote-getters are going to have three-year terms. The fourth best vote-getter is going to have a one-year term to fill the remaining time of a board member who has stepped down. So since you're distinguishing yourself, I wanted to get the terrain of what you're distinguishing. So go ahead, Luke.
Now, again, thank you, everybody, for tuning in and being here. I think a few things that distinguish me, and again, I don't know everybody as in depth. I know them as much as most of the community, so I don't want to push down or be any less than anyone, but I think what brings me up is a commitment to the community, the experiences not only professionally and personally that I can bring to the board, but the leadership and the ability to support the staff, the students, and the administration to carry out the mission of this district. I think you need a lot of communication, a lot of transparency, someone who's not afraid to ask questions, as well as someone who's not afraid to work collectively to come to the best solution. I believe in clear, precise communication, being open with the public and the administration, and working as a team. And what I do professionally is team-based, and I think that our role, not only as a board member, but myself, is one that can bring that team cohesively together and really elevate what we're doing to provide the mission, the tools, and the support we need to the district and the students.
Okay, great. I imagine I'm going to see six other hands here because you all have things that are going to distinguish yourselves. But go ahead.
So I'm Alyssa Cortina, yes. So thank you again, just to echo everybody else. So one thing that does distinguish me is I am a middle school teacher. And if that doesn't answer your question, so it is my 14th year of teaching. I've only ever taught in Title I urban education settings. I was recruited by Teach for America to teach in Miami-Dade County Public Schools, which was the fourth largest school district in the nation at the time when I taught there. I was Rookie Teacher of the Year out of the district, the large district, when I first got there. And since then, the 14 years, I've been able to learn a lot, both in the classroom and outside of it, specifically when it comes to like policy rules and other things like that, that the community might not necessarily understand. I've been able to translate a lot of that to like my friends and family that do live in Baldwinsville. My husband is also a principal in Syracuse City School District where I teach. We've also only ever dealt with TSI schools, which is the label that Baldwinsville Central School District is now coming under. And so we do understand the ESSA, and I understand the ESSA laws and the policies that go along with that, to make sure that the funding is available for schools, which is a different funding stream that Baldwinsville has seen before, hasn't seen.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, and thank you again. So I work in change management. Part of my responsibility is to go into communities, have conversations, and help them work towards a common goal of better serving service members, veterans, and their families. So I'm sure, as you can imagine, we are met with a number of challenges, a number of times where we have to have open, honest communication of what serves the whole of the community. So in the past 7 years working for the university, previously for the Army, consistently having really tough conversations, open to compromise, and looking for the best common goal. So excited to be able to bring that to the board and bringing the community together to have that conversation.
Thank you. Andrew, do you have anything that you want to add for yourself?
Again, thank you for all coming. Thank you for putting this on. I think my experience at Liverpool for the 8.5 years demonstrates my commitment to the community. And when my wife and I moved here to Baldwinsville, we began to get that sense of community. And I think as a board member, we have to keep in mind that when we make these decisions, it's really about the kids. And if you can keep that in the back of your mind all the time, and when you make a decision, make sure you're making it for the right reasons. Thank you.
right down the line.
Perfect. So there's a lot of people here who know me, and there's a lot of you who don't. And if you know me, you know that I am fully immersed in this community, whether it is on the board of the Little League, whether it is on the PTA, whether it's a part of the Rotary Club. You generally see me any day of the week, not at my house, but out somewhere else. But if you do also truly know me, you know that I'm thoughtful, I'm reasonable, I do research, and I don't work with my heart, I work with my head. And of course, while heart is always here, I'll push back on Andrew slightly, I do not see children in the back of my mind. The children are in the front of my mind, always. Because everything that happens on this board directly impacts my children and the children of the multiple people in this room. So I really think I work with integrity and I'm able to be a bridge builder and work with people of all stripes, of all political considerations, and truly believe that there's never one way of thinking. We don't live in blacks and whites. We live in a world of gray. And it's important to see things in that gray area and work within that gray area.
Thank you. Tom?
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I'd also like to thank our sponsors, and thank you all for coming out. And I want to say, probably never said, Grant, it's kind of a thankless thing. The good news is I don't think anybody here is really in it for the thanks. I think kind of we're in it for the kids. And so that's probably what motivates everybody up here. The reason I'm running, frankly, is because I just love schools, I love kids, I love educating, I love being around it. It's just kind of naturally who I am. One of the things that maybe sets me apart a little bit, as we went over briefly, a lot of my experiences overseas is with international schools, American curriculum, but they're in the international settings, most of it was in China. And I know some of you are trying to figure out how do you do American curriculum in China, and the answer is very, very carefully and very quietly. But one of the things that sort of, I'm kind of a little bit of a risk taker, a little bit entrepreneurial, and in a private school, you can do some things that aren't typically done in schools back here. And a lot of the things that we do in international schools, I was working at, this is going to sound sort of snotty, but I apologize. These were elite schools. These were some of the best schools in the world. And they do things in very, very different ways. They connect with kids differently. They connect teachers with kids differently. They connect administrators directly with kids differently. And so I think one of the things I bring is maybe a little bit of that.
Thank you, Grant. Let me just one thing clear. So the order on the website, which you read, the order of the bios on the website, is the order of on the ballot. So you will see the names in that order of the ballot just for information purposes. So what makes me different? Well, 40 years in Baldwinsville, a lot of the people I know, I've talking here tonight, I've come across you and we've worked together or done various projects together. I was the volunteer of the year a few years ago in Baldwinsville, so this community is in my blood. I'm doing it again after 12 years, 5 years as president, 1 year as vice president, because I care. The students are really important. This community is important. So, but that experience is going to be critical because I have working relationships already with many of the staff, many of the teachers, that will allow me to be effective immediately. You don't come in and work with somebody unless you know them and they know you and trust you. So that's going to be really important. I've been through the budgeting here. I've been through the academics here. I know the district pretty well. I was last on the board in 2019, so I missed out on some of the recent stuff. But I want to tell you, this is a great community. The board here, the school district here, is not broken. It may have some cracks, but we can heal it very quickly.
Thank you, Victor. That's a perfect segue to the next question. Now, is that our timers? Westminster Times? Okay. All right. Just want to make sure it's coming from a voice of authority. That's a perfect segue to our next question, and Alyssa, you're up first on this one. And it's this.
Again, middle school teacher, can't stop.
Thank you. Is there a particular problem that you perceive in either the district or the way that the school board is currently operating that is a significant part of your motivation?
Absolutely. So, not to say that I don't love where I live, and absolutely, my husband and I bought our forever home in 2016 in Beeville. My kids are in first grade and pre-K. I'm going to be around for a while. They're going to be around for a while in this district. But one of the problems that I did see, and don't necessarily have a problem speaking up for myself, I hope that's obvious, number one, from middle school teacher, but I also, my entire life I played sports against Beeville as a Liverpool kid. just in the competitive nature, right, you can always fix things, right? If you don't have a growth mindset, it's not going to work in general. If there was one perfect answer for schools or school districts, I'm sure that we would have it and we would be able to implement it, right? So that open mindset, open growth mindset, I think is number one. Not saying that it was missing at all, but what was missing was transparency and that idea of how do we transparently tell the community, all stakeholders, specifically the ones in charge of children and learning and what we're here to do, how do we make sure that we hear everybody's voice? How do we make sure that information is disseminated in an equitable way that reaches everyone, not just one, you know, one school or one middle school or one high school, but everyone as a community? And then really focusing on community schools as a focus, I think, does help with transparency because those people are at the schools already, so they're able to disseminate the information. Okay.
Okay. Let me, before we get you, Lindsay, let me then say two things. One is, or ask one question and say one thing. Transparency was a major theme of the questions that we got. Probably not a big surprise to you. You're all sure.
Yeah.
So we're going to spend some time on that. So you don't have to provide the solution on that now, because we're going to circle back.
Okay.
So my first question to the group of you before Lindsay gets up and adds what the problem is that she is running about. Does anybody of the seven of you think that transparency is not a problem currently? Okay. So there's no one's going to stand up and say this is not an issue. All right. Okay. Go ahead.
Thank you, and thank you for level setting that. I'm glad that we're all on the same page there. So I've seen nothing but a dysfunctional Board of Education that refuses to work together and refuses to work with the community. I'm sure many of you may have heard my voice or seen me at the board meetings in the past year speaking directly about that, where I sat in front of nine faces in my community that rarely responded, rarely added any input, rarely answered any questions. Typically a form letter that I got from Mrs. Lyle from the superintendent's office, which I appreciated, but no actual communication with a community member, which is really challenging. What I would like to see and do as a board member is bring the community into the conversation. We have a lot of healing to do. There's a lot of mistrust. And I think that needs to be rebuilt. I think that we've got some great leaders in the district office in our buildings, and I think it's time to trust them and start fixing the relationships on the board. I look forward to working with some of the folks here and the current board members that will still be there, and hope that there will be some more collaboration, communication, and mending our relationships. Thank you.
Okay, we've got lots of folks on there. Go ahead, Andrew, and then Don, and then
I agree with both these ladies on what they said. I also decided to run for the board because of the way we handled the situation. I think that needs to be said tonight. I think the board was not transparent, and that's one of our issues, but I also think there was a better way to do what the board should have done with this superintendent. I believe the superintendent should have been fired. I don't believe we should have hired an outside superintendent to fill the end of the school year if we were just going to hire the acting superintendent to fill that role July 1st.
Thanks for that, Andrew. I want to follow that up just a little bit and put a little bit finer point on the superintendent thing. But for the school board, the current board has been, I don't want to overstate it, but I think it's kind of hard to overstate. It's difficult to do that. It's been fantastically divided for some period of time. And in fact, in the beat, in the newsletter, we've got Dr. DeBarbieri on the front as the next soup. The board was divided in its vote whether or not they should offer him a contract. He knows the district. He's been here for a long time, and I'm not here campaigning for him, but I've met him once or twice, and I think he's a fantastic administrator. I think he's a great choice. But the board couldn't come to terms with that, and I would think that would be an easy selection, an easy choice. The one suit that has recently left, I agree. I think we should handle that very, very differently. I'm not an attorney, but I've worked with different boards in different schools in different ways. There was absolutely, in my opinion, maybe a missed opportunity there to save some of the money that we paid out, and perhaps litigated that. If we have an opportunity to get into that, I can describe that a little bit better. I think maybe we sold a little quickly on that one.
Victor,
you're
here.
Yes, thank you. I have thoughts and opinions on what happened, but guess what? I want to go to the future. I don't want to rehash the past. It won't do us any good to rehash the past. Lack of transparency is lack of communication and collaboration. And that's what we need to do. I was very disappointed at some board meetings I attended because the public was there, they expressed their thoughts very well, and they weren't listened to. The board needs to listen, and you need to have the community connections, which I just talked about. 40 years I have community connections. But we need better listening, we need collaboration, we need to communicate with our neighbors, we know that, on capital improvements. But it is important. The budget, the capital improvements are important. This area is going through a watershed event. We could be amazingly different in 5 and 10 years. And our district needs to keep up with that. So we need the budget. We need capital improvements so we can get back to being the best school in this county. So when people coming in looking at housing and looking at places to live, they think of Baldwinsville first.
Any other? Yeah, go ahead.
I agree with the topic that there's an issue that we need to do. I also believe that looking into the future is what we're all here for. And I think healing some of that communication transparency is important. I think working with our teachers, administrators, and the community. I think that as a board, we need to be bigger with our open communication and our reasoning behind the decisions that we put forth for the district. Whether that communication be a larger explanation of what we're doing, why we're doing it, or just as simple, as we did in the newsletter, simple flyers, but with the why. If we can't explain the why behind our decisions, the why a vote is split, are we keeping it a secret, or are we just not releasing that information? And to remove some of that fogginess, I think is extremely important. And the way we do that is through community involvement, through listening, as well as answering some of these questions or having opportunities for this interaction with our community members. And I really support fixing or healing some of this lack of communication moving forward.
All right, so let's, okay. All right, but Lori's gonna, because you've started, as
yes,
I recall. So go ahead. We're getting into rebuttal stage.
It's okay,
we can rebut.
It's all right.
Go ahead,
so
the biggest thing this community as a whole needs right now and this board needs right now is some real positivity. There's been a lot of negativity that's gone out, whether through vitriolic comments from the community, whether through infighting on the board. And what we need are bridge builders. We need people who are willing to listen. We need people who are willing to negotiate. And on a separate topic, I think we have a real problem with whatever legal counsel our board is getting right now, with how we handle the superintendent situation. And moreover, though I completely support his hiring, why we hired and announced a hire for a superintendent without a contract. That puts the district in a really bad position right now and gives complete leverage to the person we're bringing in. So with thoughtful, actual action to make sure things are properly put into place, that contracts are properly written, we would have never been in this place to begin with. And hopefully, God willing, we are not in this situation moving forward, but we need people with level heads who are smart, who are thinking straight with their thinking caps on and willing to talk to one another to actually understand how this all should work. And I'm willing to do that research and be that person and help to be there. So, yeah.
Great, thanks. Alyssa, very quickly, because you've already had a go with this one, so, and because I want to get into the transparency next. So
basically, that's what I was going to say. I have a hard time, I think, because I come from a Teach for America background, with buzzwords. Buzzwords such as transparency, right, or equity, or communication. Those words don't mean anything if you don't have, like, an implementation plan, right? We can say we want more communication all we want, but what does that look like? Are we going to have meetings at Baldwinsville Library every month? Maybe. But I do think something that this district does need to tap into is our technological resources and the way things are moving in the future. For instance, I am unfortunately part of a school district that is a TSI school district, meaning it's under the state purview and everything is under state purview. And while I do believe we need to be positive, I don't think our community understands how negative this district will look if it's under state purview, which SDSD is where I do work. I want to be positive, I want to be optimistic, but I also want to be defensive, and I want to be truthful, and I want to be honest. You get hired for a job before you sign a contract. That's just how superintendent contracts work. And so, like, things like that are things that, it's two-way communication. Communication doesn't just mean people yelling at us and us yelling at people. That's not communicating, right? You're not listening, and you're listening to answer rather than to understand. And so, like, that's just something that I don't want this us to get mixed up with, is buzzwords. Like, what do the buzzwords actually mean, and how can we implement them in our community?
So let's think about this transparency and think about ways that the seven of you think it can be improved. And the questions here covered a lot of different dimensions of this, but transparency was definitely, and communication was definitely a theme. So Dawn, you're up first on this one. And let me frame the question about transparency. So now we've identified it as a problem, all seven of you. And you've talked about it a little bit, and we've heard some things about how to make it better. I want to get into now what changes that you would, specific changes that you would make to enhance transparency and responsiveness. Now, just to contextualize this a bit, Dawn, before you answer, there are a couple specific aspects of this problem that several different questioners brought up. One is, and I've seen this play out myself, you want to be transparent as a board, but there are legal things to consider, and you've always got lawyers talking in your ear. So given that concern about, we can't talk about personnel, you know, we have to worry about liability, we did this and that, how can you be more transparent with those sort of legal constraints on you, is the first element of this. And the second one is an assertion that one of the folks asking a question may, I don't know whether we wanted to read the names of folks that put their names on this call, I'll leave it anonymous, but if you wanted to have your name put to it, I apologize. But this also came up in what one of you said already, is, and so I don't know whether this is truthful or not, I'm just relaying the question here, but that the Board of Education does not typically respond to emails, or has not
recently. I'm not allowed to answer them. If you email one board member, that email is sent to all the board members and then you don't get a reply. That's an issue of the problem of transparency that this particular constituent identified. So there's a desire to see, I guess, a freeness in answering publicly to questions that get put up in public settings. So how are you going to approve this specifically, also given the fact that you've got to worry about the law here?
That's an awesome question, right?
And 90 seconds are less.
Did you go over time with that question? So a couple things as I'm taking notes. The lawyers work for us, and so if I don't know of any state law necessarily related to education that says that we cannot communicate information to parents and taxpayers and to students and to administrators and to teachers in a way that protects, you know, the veil wherever confidentiality is required, but also allows moms and dads and everybody in the community to understand what's happening, make smart decisions. I don't think there's a law against that type of thing. And because the lawyers work for us, I think that we probably ought to be asking them when we come up against something like that, if there's something statutory that we need to sort of be careful of, we need to ask them, how do we say this to, you know, the folks in the community? What are the things we can say, what are the things we can't say, and push that envelope a little bit. I want to say this. Maybe I can't use these words. How do I say it? Like I said, they work for us, so we need to be able to use them. I'm not so sure that this isn't really just a whole series of missed opportunities, really. Transparency is important, and to the degree that the board has missed the opportunity to be transparent, you see no incumbents up here. And so there are consequences to that. We don't have, right now, the current board doesn't, as far as I know, doesn't really have any feedback loops from the community. You know, as I go door to door talking to people about the campaign, I knock on doors at houses across the street from the school, and I get told, I'm going to vote for you because no candidate's ever come to my door before. So there are things that we can do, things we should do. Finding those feedback loops is really important.
Thank you. Anybody want to add to what Don? Yeah, go ahead. I'll get you, Lindsay, and then we'll get Andrea. Those are the first two hands I saw. And I also want to further frame, I want to pursue this for a little bit because it was such a big theme, but go ahead.
So I know I brought up the form letter that you got back from the district office once you spoke at a board meeting. I think what's challenging, and I have reached out to different board members individually and as an entire board, and you do get that copy all everybody, and it feels very much like a prescripted written email that answers out specific questions in a very, very legal manner. I think there's a balance between legal and PR. I think what we had on our hands as a district was a PR nightmare, and we desperately needed some advisement and some board leadership that was willing to assume some risk in having an open and honest conversation with the community, because I think that's what was really lacking. Yes, there was a legal process that had to occur to remove a superintendent from the building, but educating the community on that process was key, which was never done. There was never a, hey, go to the state website and you can see when you're allowed to put somebody on admin leave versus when you can put somebody on unpaid leave. So being able to share those resources and have that communication, I think would have been really, really important of pointing to those resources instead of just saying, we're going to process. We're going to follow this process. We're still working through the process. Thank you for being patient. We're working through a process. That doesn't help anybody. So I think being able to have that conversation, assuming risk on your own, of saying, opening the door to have that communication, here's my phone number, here's my email, and being able to talk to folks.
Thank you. Andrew.
I think it's important that the community understands that the things that are done in executive session are things that the board cannot come back out and talk about. And that's by New York State education law. So I think that's important that people understand that. Now with that said, when a board votes 5-4 for a new superintendent and there's no discussion whatsoever, that's not healthy for the community. and let's break that to transparency. Why wasn't there a discussion? And I think the new board, whoever it may be, along with the five members that are still be there, need to sit down, have some guidelines to say, we need to do a better job communicating with our community. So when we do have a vote, let's have a discussion first. Discussions are healthy, because then the people in the audience understand what each of us may have to say and where each of us may be coming from. And if we can do that as a board, you're going to have a healthy board from here on out. Thank you.
Anybody else want to jump in on this one? Yeah, Rick, you're right.
Some of the things that have been said are very on point, I believe, and I think more feedback would be great. I do think better responses when people come to talk to the board, and you can't really have the discussion there maybe because you've got a lot of things that you're meeting and you've got a certain agenda to go, but responses should contain answers. And emails to board members should be replied to and should be discussed among the board so there's a good reply. So those things need to happen more if they haven't been happening. The other thing is we need better communication. One of the things that I think is on the issue of safety in our schools, it's one of the most important topics to me. There's various communications going out from various schools, even though there's a set protocol. So I would propose that a district safety and security person be established so that we have a focal point for that safety and security. We need to do something to work with all these SROs. We have SROs in every building, but who coordinates that? Who coordinates transportation safety? If we have one person, we can improve that safety and improve that part of the communication. We just need other steps to improve other communication, and part of that's a trust issue. Part of it's a trust issue. Thank you.
I just wanted to add on to what I think is has been very, very intelligent answers. And one thing just to suggest is there are forums that, such as Canvas, if you've gone back to college or if you have a high schooler or middle schooler, Canvas is a platform where you have discussion questions, such as like there could be a Canvas platform or a Talking Points platform or a Jamboard platform where you can post questions and answers underneath, and they have to be approved by certain people. But it is a form of communication that the entire community would be able to see, with answers directly being on the shoulders of board members because their response time is visible, right? So there are like different technological ways to get a, like to do the full feedback circle, right? That's what we say in education, coaching cycle, right? You watch anyways, middle school. But so the point is like there are different ways to get information out and get it out quicker and hear back quicker, right? So the different people with different knowledge bases, we can come together as a team and make the best decisions possible. And just as a heads up, the law is ESSA, if anybody wants to Google it. It's the new No Child Left Behind. Basically, it's No Child Left Behind 2.0. But ESSA is the New York State law that we have to follow as far as policies are concerned. And now as a TSI school district, there are a lot more strict, like very, very strategic things that we have to do in order to even access our own money.
So without seeing any other hands on this one, let me tell you what I think I've heard on the transparency. And then I invite pushback, correction, further commentary, because again, this was just such a big theme of the question. I'm hearing that what needs to change is more of the culture rather than instituting a certain set of new policies. Now, those aren't necessarily opposed, but that's what I've been hearing. Do I interpret silence as agreement with that assessment? It's the culture that you think needs to change, not we need to pass, okay, the board is now going to pass this rule for itself. All emails will be answered, or something of that nature. Okay. All right. Okay. All right, well, Tori, you're up on the first on this next one. All right, so I'll wait to get into that one. We've got a couple other sort of big controversial topics here, but let me ask this question. The budget obviously is a huge issue for the school board. Perhaps what you could do here, Tori, going first, is a question about what your budget priorities would be. Because you have to always make those kinds of decisions. You have to make those kind of value judgments. So first, I think, what's the role of the school board in the budgeting? I think that needs to be made clear to everybody. Because it varies from place to place, can vary. And then secondly, and more to the point, what would be your most important priorities in thinking about the budget?
So again, looking at this from the perspective that I have from the rescue mission is, one, the budget itself is not developed by the board. The board is not out here creating the budget. The board helps put forth the budget, but really we are looking to the department heads of each part of the district. They are the experts on their area, and they understand what the specific needs are. As a board, we have to work within the parameters that we're given, which is pretty much we are limited by the state property tax cap, what we can raise the tax levy by. So you cannot raise your budget amount by more than that. You also have to stay within the foundation aid and what they're giving you there in order to work within that space of the budget. So I encourage individuals in this room, if the budget is important to you, to join a budget committee. You will quickly learn the understanding of the ins and outs of a specific department. I had the opportunity to sit on the transportation budget a few years ago and really get a keen understanding of why we have a rotating capital budget for replacement vehicles, why we need 14 new buses this year. So for me personally, and this role is I'm here to ask questions of the individuals who are putting forth their budgets. Why are we doing these increases? Why is this item needed? But it is not my job to come up here and say, we need to give $10 million for this one thing. That's not my job. And that's not the job of anyone here on this board. But we are here to provide advisement and to help communicate what that budget is to you, the voters, so that you know to vote yes on all of those propositions on May 16th.
Thanks. Go ahead, Luke. You're the first. Thank you. I'm actually going to tie that to the previous question, too, because I think the budget support, as taxpayers, there's a lot of burdens, especially when property assessments go up. Well, wouldn't inherently the school budget go up? So I think it's important that when the board presents the budget, when the board holds the administration accountable for presenting and forming this budget, that we communicate. That we give the whys behind for every increase that we're doing, because it's a hard pill to swallow when year after year after year it's going up, up, up. Again, important reasons why. Perhaps buying all these buses is cheaper than maintaining the older ones. So say that. Some of our neighboring districts have very large comprehensive budgets that are really tailored to the very individual or very easy to understand way that a middle schooler could read and say, oh, we need budgets because it cost, or we need new buses because it costs less to fix the old ones. Very simple, very easy. And I think part of that communication and transparency, and again, the reason why behind we're asking the community to increase their tax base for our students, for our schools, for our teachers is extremely important. I think the budget's a very high priority, but I also think the communication behind it, the explanations, and the community involvement to be able to easily see what we're asking of is extremely important as well. So again, I think that the two can go together, but the budget is definitely one thing that I am happy to help with if I'm able to get onto the board. Thank you.
Others want to jump in on this? Yeah, Victor, go ahead.
Very briefly, my first priority is always student-facing people. So when I look at the budget, and I've looked at 12 of them so far, I always look at the program piece and how many teachers, aides, support staff do we have. And I'm happy to say the administrative piece here is about 8.6%. We've always prided ourselves on keeping the administration low and most of the money going to program, which is the teachers, student support, et cetera, et cetera. So that's, I think, important. The other thing is I do think this year about $63 million is coming from local share from school taxes. About $65 million is projected from other things. Good news this year, they've foundation aid has been fully restored. by New York State, so that helps things. I do agree with what Troy said. You have a budget cap, and you have a very complicated formula to tell you how much you get every year. So it becomes very, very carefully planned out. But you do question line items, and I know when something goes up over a couple of percent, the question needs to be raised, and that needs to be communicated to the public, because it can be a very confusing process. The school budgets, school finances, anything else.
All right, well, let me build off of what Victor said and pose a follow-up question on the budget priority issue. Do any of you, because he mentioned student-facing staff getting, and he wants to make sure that they're fully and properly funded. Do any of you want to make the case that there's one area that's currently being underfunded that needs to get more funding, and therefore you have to also be willing to say, here's where I'm going to get that money. So Melissa, your hand shot up. So here are just some examples. We could say like special ed needs more funding, you know, or sports needs more funding, or music, or whatever. So go ahead. Where do you see the deficiency right now?
So I think that this leads to a larger question of another large problem that pushed me to want to run for the Board of Education, which is equity. And talking about the difference between equity and equal, every elementary school doesn't mean the same thing, right? Every elementary school, every teacher doesn't mean the same thing. Every classroom doesn't mean the same thing. And equity means that every kid, we're talking student facing, or staff member, or building, or administration, or district office, actually listening to what they need, because I'm assuming most people feel the same way, but I personally bought my house in Baldwinsville because I wanted my children to go to school in Baldwinsville. And the reason was because of the equity, the ability to, that I've seen, my child was in a CT classroom, and when a child needed something, the school was responsive to what that child needs. And I like to give the example to my daughter, if you cut your finger and you need a Band-Aid, everybody doesn't get a Band-Aid. You need a Band-Aid. Right, so like to be equitable in a budgeting process, I think is also key. Asking people what they need. Some schools don't need extra teachers. Some schools have classroom sizes that are 35. Some schools have special education, but maybe it can be programmed differently to help the budget rather than, because we work for a district, not for a school. Right, so making sure that it's equitable across the board for what every student, what every family, whatever stakeholder needs.
Are there any other, who want to talk about one area versus another? Yeah, go ahead. Lindsay.
I think what is really amazing about our district is within our district office, Danielle has done an incredible job of building out a dashboard that you can see on our website, and you can see all of the demographics of our students, and that can help us make data-driven decisions in the budget, in the classrooms, further on down the road when we're looking at children that may have a special need, come from a single-parent household, have other considerations that you're not thinking about, but can be able to make those decisions for the budget based on those. And I just think that she deserves like a huge round of applause for all the work. You can see their presentation that they did for NISBA and a couple of other places, but it's really incredible, and what we're able to do and we're doing at this district that others aren't, and setting that example. So they're doing an incredible job there.
Anybody else want to jump in on the budget issue? Okay, Andrew, you're up first on this next one. We're going to move to school principals now. So the question is, how much autonomy should school principals have for the running of their schools?
I think each principal should be able to run the school the way he or she sees fit, given the guidelines that the school district gives he or she to do that. One building may do special programs this way, and another one may do special programs another way. So I think each principal should have the ability to run their schools the way they think is best. That's why we hire them. We're not changing principals over every year. There is some turnover, and there's going to be turnover, but I think we have to give the trust to those principals that they're doing the right things for the students and their village.
Maybe I want to pose a slightly different view on autonomy. Luke? Yeah.
So I agree what Andrew said with autonomy and the principals, but I also believe there's some piece of accountability or oversight. Now, I think the principals should run their buildings as appropriate. It is what we hired them for, but I also believe that when a building is in need of some guidance, assistance, or leadership, and that the district and administration step in to offer them the support they need in order to bring a building up, and also allow that openness for that autonomy to occur freely, meaning that they have the ability to come and ask for help, and it's encouraged to. There are some buildings that need some help, needs a little bit of improvement with how they're being run, and I think there also needs to be a channel for that communication to identify the need, as well as offer that principal the support, but while holding them accountable to do the job they've been hired to do. So, but I do think I agree with them that they should have the autonomy to run the building as long as we have the ability to make sure it's run to the district standard.
I don't want to dominate the comment, sorry. So I want to, I appreciate everything that everybody has said. I truly believe that your principal sets the tone of your buildings. I can speak from our personal experience, not in this school district, but he lived in this community. Our principal that my children started out with was the most incredible human being that we've ever had. And he set the tone for that entire building. You walked into that building and you felt his spirit. And he treated his staff amazing. He treated his kids like their own. And that gave us as a family an incredible experience, and have felt some of that in Beeville, but also have seen other principals that may have not felt as supported, haven't been as animated as others, and you can feel it in the teachers across the building. So I think that there is, yes, that autonomy, be yourself, thrive in your building, support your staff, but there's also a set of standards and character that we expect in our Baldwinsville school districts.
Yeah, Tom, go ahead.
So when I was principaling, I had sort of my favorite people that I like to see walk in the building, and the people that I hoped would never darken my doorstep again. And both of those people were board members. The types of relationships that we were talking about, the board members themselves having, member-to-member peer relationships, those relationships have to exist between administrators, whether it's a superintendent, a deputy, office staff, principals, vice principals, teachers, and board members as well. Those relationships, this is one of the feedback loops for a board. The board's got to know what's happening with kids and with teachers and with administrators and with staff in their buildings. Without that information, the guidance that the board provides is skewed. It's off the mark. And without that feedback loop, we also can't intelligently answer any questions from moms and dads and taxpayers in the community. I think this kind of ties into sort of that transparency issue, but it's really important for board members to understand that they are a guest at schools, and they need to ingratiate themselves with the people who are running that building, the people on the ground, the kids in the classrooms. They need to be a positive influence in those buildings, not a negative one.
All right, Lindsay, you're up first on this next one. And this is a huge topic. I'm guessing we'll have a couple rounds on this. But it has to do with a lot of the debate surrounding different aspects of cultural questions going on in the country and in our school systems. So there are three parts to this question. I apologize in advance. But just to contextualize for all seven of you, you get a sense where people are coming from. We've had questions that
a very heartfelt question from someone whose child was transgendered and struggled with that in the school system, mightily struggled, and still struggling. We've had a another question from someone that is very upset to learn, according to them, again, I'm just looking at the questions, that issues of gender are being discussed in a math class. They felt like math class is for math, not for that topic. And so we have concerns coming from different experiences and points of view here on this. But what folks are looking for, I guess, from you folks is your sense of where you come down on kind of three big things. One is, 90 seconds or less, that's a joke, really, but we're going to drop it. How should race be taught in schools? How should race be dealt with in the schools? Questions of racial history, social issues regarding race. How should those things be taught? What's your stance on supporting LGBTQ plus students? And then finally, where are you on the criteria for book choices? And do you favor limiting certain books or not having certain books in your library? What would those be and why? So have at it.
This is a loaded question.
We'll work through it. You'll get a couple bites of this apple. Don't worry about
it. So first and foremost, your second question, I was internally laughing a little bit because a kid is a kid is a kid. Like, I'm a person, you're a person. I don't care if you're gay, straight, black, white, purple. You belong in our classrooms, and we should be teaching tolerance. Doesn't matter what you do, what you believe in as a board member. It doesn't matter what my belief is personally, one way or another, or what I practice in my home. It matters that our kids are here in our buildings to have an education and to graduate from our school and go off and do amazing things and hopefully come back to our Baldwinsville community. And they would be coming back because they were treated well and they wanted to be here. So I think teaching tolerance is above all everything. Also, our history is our history. I mean, we all did history class in school, and America's history is not lovely. It was built off the facts of other people, and I think it's fair to teach that. But I also trust in our educators and those that are developing our curriculum and building that to make the best decisions. And to inform, the board's not writing curriculum. That is not our job. It is our job to trust those that are much smarter than me in order to do that. And I have likely at some point voted to appoint them in that position and need to trust them because that's what they're there to do. The same thing with books. I have a really hard time at thinking of any books that should not be anywhere because greed, it's great. That's all.
Anybody want to add to what Lindsay said? And by the way, that was just a heroic effort. Thank you, Melissa. In 90 seconds. Well done there. But anybody want to add to that?
Yeah,
go ahead, Tori. I have a feeling we'll be on this topic for a little bit. And there's a question that came in that I want to use as a follow-up here from someone out there, so go ahead.
Sure, I'm going to be real unapologetic here. I do see color. I see you for the person you are, for the beauty that you bring, for the culture that you bring, for the language that you bring. I want to celebrate it. I want it to be taught. We all bring this here. Because you look at me, and who do you see? You see a white girl standing up here talking to you. But if I tell you I'm Puerto Rican, a lot of people stop and go, what? But that's who I am. And so it's rude when I hear somebody talk ill of that or say that language or that shouldn't be taught in school or that someone should just speak English. As to the LGBTQ question, again, I am be unapologetically you.
I will say I firmly am in the department of all rights and celebrating those for any belief that they have. As a part of the rescue mission, we are currently actively building a youth shelter that is affirming, accepting, and loving of LGBTQ students. The majority of the homeless youth population is LGBTQ. And on the last one, on book banning, 100% no. Every topic can be taught in an age-appropriate manner with age-appropriate books. My kids in grade in the elementary school have read about illegal immigration, they have read about race, and it's up to us as parents to follow that up. And it sure does matter what my personal beliefs are. It sure does matter what I teach my kids at home, because that 100% expressly goes out to the community.
Thank you. I saw another hand up.
I wasn't going to offer this, but it might help to sort of contextualize. And your example helped me a great deal. Contextualizing. I'm in an interracial marriage. My wife is Chinese. And so, you know, our lives are very, very different compared to what most folks, not all, but probably most folks in this room have experienced in marriage. I lived in China for 14 years working in education, and I feel very, very strongly about a particular topic, and that's academic freedom. That's kind of what American education was built on. I worked for 14 years in an education system where the party decided what kids were going to read, what they were going to see, what they were going to hear, what teachers were going to say. And I want to emphasize to every person in here that there isn't a more horrifying experience for a child in a classroom than to be formed, molded, shaped into something that they're not meant to be. The board's job is not to create little sort of models of ourselves. Book banning is about the least intellectual approach that you could possibly assume. And just from firsthand experience, you need to reconsider. If you think about book banning and editing and censoring, think about it. Age-appropriate, grade-appropriate, academic materials, absolutely. But banning books is really not the way to go.
Other comments on this? Anybody else want to jump in on this? Okay. Victor, I want to, you know, this is a follow-up to this question, a more specific version of it that someone here asked. And that is, they want to know, is there currently, and you may not know the answer to this, but is there currently a district policy regarding gender and gender confusion, name changes, pronoun changes? What is it? And then how should the school be responding to the child and the parent when those things come up?
Well, I would have commented on the last, but I knew that you said you got a follow-up.
Well, you can comment on that one.
And I will, yeah. So I am not sure about a current policy. You are correct. I don't know. But one of the things I say on my platform is that every student counts. And I mean that. Every student, and this was well said, every student should be honored, celebrated, and recognized. And I've never, ever voted against a book on the school board before, and I never will. Whatever the teacher recommends, that's what I'm for, you know? It is that, and back to the safety and security issue I brought up earlier, one of the things I do fear is kids aren't being protected, there may be some bullying going on, and that's the reason we need more focus on safety and security, and we need people that are defending these kids and teaching other kids what it means to be different. We are all better. We get so many gifts and so much from every different race and every different gender identity that it is. Why don't we recognize how rich it is? Recognize
if we talk about it, if we talk, have that conversation, we'll realize we all have more in common than we have in difference. But we need to teach these kids this. We need to encourage that. So that's where I stand.
Thank you. Does any of the group have knowledge about what the district policy currently is on this? Okay, one hand shot up. All right. And then my second part of the question is, and does anybody have opinions on how this should be handled when it does come up for the children and the parents? Go ahead, tell us the situation. Melissa, go ahead.
I don't even know it all, and I hate this, but I do graduate this month, and that's why it's fresh in my mind as far as policy is concerned. So the district policy the New York State policy is that whatever gender or identity that a student chooses for themselves is what the teacher or the school or in a public education forum, that is the mandate that the teacher or the staff member or whoever works for the public district respect that child's pronouns, respect that child's identity. But it's also policy, New York State policy, that you're not, as a staff member, you're not allowed to express that to that student's family. So that is a New York State law as part of ESSA. And I do think it can get dicey, right? Like, I think we're talking about morality being taught in schools as a subject or just social skills in general. And then I do think, as someone who does heavily support LGBTQIA+ community, I do think there's some work that can be done there as far as New York State and Baldwinsville's specific policies to make sure that we're doing more to help than to harm. Because again, we're talking about transparency, and that doesn't help. That doesn't help, right? Like we very much know that hurts, doesn't help, and it needs to come to an understanding where we're not pitting, you know, children versus families or schools versus families or, you know, anything like that. We're working together towards success.
Anybody else on this topic? Okay, we're about 10 minutes away from our end time, and I've gotten some good questions from folks out in the audience, but one of the other themes, and I want to move on, have time to talk about this, was safety in the schools. Victor brought up one element of it, which is bullying and sort of what happens inside the school, student to student. But we did get a lot of questions about school safety more generally, and I think they've been informed by some of the school shootings that we have been reading about in recent months. And so, Luke, you're up next, I believe, on my list here. So the question is, what kinds of things would you be willing to do as a school district to try to shore up and strengthen the safety of the school? Specific example that was put forward in one of the questions was educating families about proper storage of firearms. Is that something the school ought to be getting involved in? Just how would you go about trying to increase the general safety of schools?
So I think safety of our students in our schools is extremely important. It's a good question. And if it was up to me, I would do everything possible to make sure our students are safe. And fortunately, we have fiscal limits, we have policy limits, but I would do everything I could. I think some of the topics, again, Victor mentioned it, working with our SROs is important. I think working with our school administrators is important. And I also think communication with parents is important. And I say that because some of the previous topics with students that have feelings of being left out or bullying, I think that is a cohesive relationship that the administrators and the parents of the students involved on both sides of all parties need to work together. I think it comes with education with those parents for those situations that are not desirable within our schools, but I also think working with the tools and things we currently have, shoring up some of the things we currently have, and offering that safety in the buildings in the district, so when students come in, they don't feel unsafe. So when a student walks through that door, they feel welcome, whether it's because of the other topics before or whether it becomes because they feel threatened or bullied or they have a violent history. So I think it starts with using the tools we have, increasing the tools that, as Victor said, as well as working more with their parents and opening the lanes of communication between those kids involved and our administrators.
Lots of hands up here, Tori.
I wanted to talk about this during the budget one, but I didn't have an answer on what I would cut. So I'm just going to put it out there. The number one thing I think we can do to make our schools safer is invest in the mental health of our students. 100%. The violence that we see in our schools right now, these massive school shootings, are happening because of the mental health of our kids. And I don't know how we get there yet. I'm not saying I have the answer, but in a lot of our elementary schools, we're talking about a building of hundreds of kids, or in our middle schools, we have one school psychologist and one social worker. That's not enough. And I don't know what the right number is. And I'm not saying I'm that expert, because I want to leave that to the experts. But I do know that what these kids have gone through, you know, what we've all gone through, is really a real issue with a mental health crisis right now in this country, in our schools. And I'm going to echo Luke, the communication is the number one thing. I'm going to tell you all something that happened at McNamara. Somebody drew a swastika on a wall. A child did. Do you want to know how many parents were notified? One. Me. And when I brought it up to the district that maybe we ought to tell all the parents so that we can be proactive in safety, I was told, legally, we don't have to do that. So we have to communicate this, because this safety is relevant to everyone. And it's relevant when it's a graffiti, and it's relevant when kids' mental health is at stake. So that's an area I think we can invest in.
Thank you. And Tori, thank you for bringing up mental health. I think that's incredibly important. I'm actually fortunate enough to sit on the district's mental health wellness committee. I think where we need to be is the community needs to be involved more in it. So there's been a number of different communications that have gone out this month, being Mental Health Awareness Month. There's a few different presentations to have community members and parents learn more about mental wealth or mental health. What you need to do as families, talking about legal means safety, talking about bullying, talking about how to have really tough conversations at home with your kids. I think that's where it starts. I also do want to say that I, as a parent of two kids in the school district, feel safe sending my kids to school every day. I think that we've invested appropriately early on with some SAFE Act money to have safety precautions in our schools. I think they're taking advantage of additional stuff. We had that thought exchange that came out a few weeks ago, and they're going to start putting metal detectors in our buildings based on that thought exchange that the community participated in. I think what's really important, and hopefully be able to do as a board, is that we need to have a serious conversation about what zero tolerance actually means and allowing the building to be able to put that into effect. We have situations where kids have made some very serious threats in our buildings and then are locked back. Where we need to have a conversation with the board and looking at our policy of when restorative justice is okay and when we need to say this is enough and you're putting our kids in jeopardy and disrupting our education environment.
Thank you.
So I absolutely agree with everyone who has made sentiments about this before. Just as on a personal note, so I've been in two school shootings as a teacher this past year. My student was Brexy, the student who was murdered around the same time Ava was. And then my teaching assistant was actually trampled and murdered in Manchester this year. So again, when we're talking about previously, like being positive, I really want to be positive, but I also want to warn what it looks like when New York State takes over your district and what those metal detectors look like and what it looks like. Because it, unfortunately, is New York State law that you can't, it's educational neglect to kick a kid out of a school, right? Like, there has to be so many things. I just went to two hearings for kids to try to get them alternate programming. I've been stabbed. I've been punched in the face last month. I'm told every single day that someone's going to F my mom or K me. or like these are things that happen every day in districts that are underfunded, in districts that are not ran appropriately, in districts without proper leadership, in large districts where there isn't communication. And then just to echo, I want to push back on is that the school shooters of today went through all these trainings. Yes. They did all the, they know where people are hiding. They know where, they know not to answer when you knock. They know these things, right? So to echo the mental health statement, right? But also then we're talking about a community school setting. We're talking about bringing in mental health providers. We're talking about bringing in community-based organizations into schools, and that's a community school model. And so I would really push people to think of that. The two worst experiences of my life were when my kindergartners were in the cafeteria and there was a gunman in my school, and it was the worst feeling I've ever held. I hope no one ever has to feel like that, but that person with a gun knew exactly where everybody was. And so it's just something to think about.
Thank you. Don. And then I want to squeeze one last question in that came in on a topic we were talking about before, but it's really on point and echoes a couple other questions. So go ahead, Don, and we'll get them. That'll be the last one.
Yeah, this is another one, very, very personal for me. Not so much campaigning, but it's important to hear the stories, right? I mentioned earlier I was principal at a school, inner city school in Chicago. It was on the near west side of Chicago, which for those of us who are old enough, you might recognize the name, the old Cabrini Green Housing Project.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, years ago they said, well, we have a crime problem here in Cabrini Green, so let's get rid of Cabrini Green. They tore the buildings down, but the people didn't go anywhere. The gang stayed, the drugs stayed, the violence stayed, the brokenness in families stayed. It all stayed there. That's where we opened our school. It was a private school. Chicago Public Schools couldn't service kids there. The only alternative were the Catholic schools, but the diocese there pulled all their schools out. And so we got a bunch of people together, and we started a school in there. There was one student, I'll use his nickname because I don't want to use his real name. His nickname was LC. He was a ninth grader. And 30 seconds to tell this story. LC was on time every day. He took the city bus to school. He rode the bus for 45 minutes. He lived a 5-minute walk from the school, but he couldn't cross gang lines, so he got on the bus. He rode the bus for 45 minutes. He was late for school one day, and nobody knew where he was. Finally called him, and he said, Mr. Miller, I need some help. He said, my grandma's on the couch. She's not breathing, and you know, I think she took my lunch money. She knows I hide in my shoe. And I think she went out of school last night, and I'm not sure how she is. I said, okay, Elsie, you stay there. We're going to call 911. We're going to get this taken care of. He said, no, I already did that. I'm calling you to see if you can give me a ride to school.
Wow.
That school was the safest place for him to be all day, every day. That's how schools need to be. That's the relationships that we need to have with the kids that we face every day. Schools need to be the safest place they can possibly be. If home is not safe, they've got to be able to trust the people they spend as much time with every day as their parents, with teachers.
Thank you. So either that clock is a little fast or my watch is a little slow, but by my watch, we've got a couple more minutes. So with the candidates and the audience indulgence, let me squeeze this last question in. So I want to go back to the issue of transparency and accountability and that potential tension between the two and relationship between the two. But this question is, and Alyssa, you're first up on this one. How can the community be more part of the process of accountability, the community members as stakeholders and investors in these kinds of hiring and tenure decisions, and I suppose even dismissal decisions, if all of this happens from within? How do you involve, to what level, and how do you involve the community and the parents and the families in these things?
So first of all, I think that stakeholder involvement across the board in a public education system is absolutely imperative. You don't, the loudest person shouldn't win. I'm saying that as someone who is married to a Cuban refugee who's just so loud and thinks loud wins, and I have to say it often to him and his two kids that are also mine, like loudest doesn't win, right? So when talking about communication and how to do a better job of it with our community, I think two-way communication is absolutely imperative. I think, but beyond that, I do think that there needs to be more formal community, I don't want to say another organization because that isn't necessarily what I mean, but a stakeholder organization that is interviewed in the same way that we're interviewing right now, that has a say in hiring, has a say in tenure, has a say in how things are going within the schools, because we don't know what it's like for everyone else's children. We don't know what it's like for other staff members in other schools. I do think that there needs to be a committee that is solely focused on the community's best interest when hiring and honestly retaining highly effective teachers, because that is, hiring them is one thing, getting them to stay is a whole other, right? And when you have schools of only non-tenured teachers, a lot of things, we're talking about the accountability factor and the, you know, what you're allowed to do and what you're not allowed to do. Well, when you don't have tenure, you're not allowed to say anything, right? So that hinders communication. If there was, if there's an entity that's interviewed and directly works with the board when it comes to hiring, firing, policies, things like that, I do think communication would work better as a community, but I do think absolutely 100% they should be just as involved as any other part of the district, because everyone's an equal stakeholder when it comes to, you know, our kids and their future.
Okay, I saw Tori's hand and Lindsay here on this one. Let's see if we got anybody else after that, and then we'll wrap up.
So again, get involved. You know, there's an elementary school right now that's looking for a new principal, and I'm pretty sure every single parent got an email today that said, are you interested in being on the committee to help hire the next principal? Do that. If you want to have a say, get involved. And I would go a step further to say, as it comes to evaluation, the one thing that boggles my mind is that I feel like a lot of people in education live their life in academics and in education, and then I sit here from the outside going, you know, sometimes maybe we should run this like a for-profit business in a way that I have to have a 360 evaluation. Who's here providing evals outside of it? As a college professor, I gotta have a bunch of kids tell me how I'm doing as an instructor. I'm not a professor, sorry. They call me a professor, I'm not, I'm an instructor. But they evaluate me. And at what point do we as parents and as community members get to help do those evaluations? There will always be disgruntled people, but if we're doing a 360 eval where teachers get to report back each year, say, hey, here's what's working with a principal, here's what's not working with a principal, and parents at the end of the year get to say, here's what's great with my kid's teacher, and here's what can be improved. It only helps everyone else improve. And certainly there's probably some district HR things that go along with that, but I think if we take a piece of that for-profit world on that evaluation and 360 look at how we're all performing, it will only make us better as a district. But again, get involved. Sit on the principal hiring committee. I know Liverpool used to have community superintendent hiring committees when that came around. Get involved, or else you don't get a say.
Lindsay, you had your hand up.
I just think that committee Elizabeth, that you were referring to, I think that is the Board of Education. I think that is your responsibility. You know, as I think someone said earlier, like the Board of Education is responsible for supervising the superintendent. I think the community is responsible for supervising the Board of Education. I think that we're responsible to answering to you. I think we're accountable to you. And I think that there should be that open door policy to be able to have that communication back and forth. I also do want to say just one thing. I was kind of sitting here reflecting and looking at our timekeeper's time, and there have been a couple of times where we have gone over and that stop sign has gone up, but there has been respect to the people that are speaking, letting them finish their thoughts. I think that is something that has been grossly missed at our Board of Education meetings, where if a community member had a few more things to say, one sentence, they are cut off immediately and incredibly rudely interrupted and stopped. I think that needs to end, and I think that we've shown more respect here to our community members than what our Board of Education has shown to us. I think that says a lot.
Any other things on this? All right, so before I thank everybody, it may seem a little cookie cutter, but I think it's important, just in case people don't know who you are, but they've been listening to what you've been saying. I'm going to do this in reverse order of how you will appear on the ballot, just to be fair to the folks at the bottom of the ballot. So just stand up when I say your name. So we just re-identify everybody. Tori Perez Shires. And now, will you be Victoria on the ballot, or Tori?
I'm all of it. I'm Victoria, Tori, Perez, Shires, because I'm known by all of those names here.
So they will all be on the ballot.
They're all there.
Okay, great. Andrew Henty. Okay, thank you. Victor Jenkins. Okay. Alyssa Cortina. All right. Donald Miller.
I'll be Donald on the ballot, but I'll be Don to all my friends.
Lindsay Atkinson. And then, last but not least, Luke Kasowski.
Thank you all for coming out today.
So I want to thank all of you folks for being here to come here to a school board candidate forum. That puts you in a very elite category of citizen. And I also want to thank the candidates and, again, the folks who organized it. So, great. You got the welcome.